Good morning, dear students. Welcome to another session of data structures introduction. So in previous this thing we had discussed regarding a few of the concepts which are pertaining to C programming. That is, we had a recap in previous sessions. Then later on we discussed few of the aspects which are related to what are the different data structures which are present, how we can go ahead with data structures. And then in that we discussed in detail regarding arrays. So we completed a discussion pertaining to arrays, and we saw few of the programs pertaining to the array concepts. That is, how do we insert an element, delete an element, how do we declare an array, array parameter. So these all things we had discussed. Now moving ahead, we move on to the next topic of data structure, which is called the linked list. So now previously we saw that what is basically array doing. So array basically helps you to store similar kind of data types, and that entire structure forms a single unit. So here major thing to note down is that it stores data types which are of the similar kind. And apart from that, what happens is if you declare an array, say you declare an array A with 10. So what this does is, this allocates 10 memory locations. It allocates 10 memory locations, and those memory locations are consecutive. That is, depending on the byte size, the address is assigned. So here, if the first address is 6000, and if it is an integer, and if we specify that it consumes 2 bytes, then next address of the element will be 6002, and so on, it will continue. So this will be done for 10 memory locations. So these 10 memory locations will be allocated for the array elements. So here what is happening? So no matter whether if you're using just the two blocks, remaining blocks will be still with the array. So what is happening is, no matter how much you want to utilize, so whether you want to utilize all the 10 memory locations or just one memory location. So in that case, whenever you declare the array, what happens is this 10 memory locations in this example will be allocated. So what happens is the fixed amount of memory space is allocated to the array. This is done before the execution. When you compile, it gets to know that this is an array which should hold 10 elements, and it indicates that it should store a data type of integer. So based on this, the 10 memory locations are allocated. So this memory, no matter how many times you say compile it, so before the execution, so what happens is it will be allocated 10 memory locations. So this memory is fixed. So this is other aspect of the array. Next, what happens is, what we observe is, this is actually a problem. Now, for example, I have only 2 elements, so which are actually the part of the array. So remaining, I am keeping it, say, for the future use. So if that is the case, what is happening is 8 memory locations are wasted. I cannot use it for any other purpose because those memory locations are allocated to the array A. So now in such cases, what happens is it becomes a problem. I cannot waste the memory in such way. So what happens is, if I have to overcome this issue, that is, say, can I utilize this 8x8 memory locations for some other purpose if it is unutilized? So what I can do? So what I have to do is I have to look for something called as dynamic memory allocation. So what is happening in this case? In this case, the memory is allocated in a static way. That is, 10 memory locations are required, 10 memory locations are allocated before the execution. So they will not be disturbed during the execution of the program. This 10 memory locations will be as it is. They will not be disturbed. So what has to be done in such cases? We have to look forward for something called as dynamic memory allocation. So that is the question with the arrays. So if it stores similar kind of data types, and if it uses fixed amount of memory space, then how I can overcome this issue? What if I require, another problem is, I have declared array of 10 and all the 10 memory locations are filled. That is, there is some data present in 10 memory locations. Suppose I get another two elements and I have to store it. I cannot do it in the dynamic form. In the static form, I cannot perform that operation. So what I have to do is I have to look forward for dynamic memory allocation. So these are the two problems what we look when we are using the arrays. So first problem is it stores similar kind of data types, but in this part we are not looking at this aspect. Next, what we are looking is it makes use of fixed memory location before the program is executed. So this 10 memory locations, what we have defined, it is allocated and it is utilized. So there are two problems in this. If only say one or two elements are to be stored, what happens? A remaining memory space is wasted. If it is not utilized, it is entirely wasted. Then if all the 10 memory locations are filled and I want to store one or more elements in this array, it is not possible. So in that case, what we look forward is we look forward for the dynamic memory allocation. I cannot go ahead with the array in this form. I cannot use dynamic memory allocations with the array what I'm defining over here. So these are the two aspects. That is, if I try to go ahead with the dynamic memory allocation, I cannot achieve it using the array. Therefore, what we do is we go for the linked list. So linked list tries to overcome this fixed memory space problem. And it looks forward for efficient utilization of the memory as compared to the array. So these are the two things which are pertaining to the linked list. Now let us move ahead and see what is linked list, how it operates, what are its advantages, what are its disadvantages, and what are the operations which we can perform using the linked list. So we have the linked list. The name itself tells that it is a list of some elements which are linked with each other. It is a list of elements which are linked with each other. So now here what we have, it's a collection of data elements that are stored in such a form that one element points to the next element. So it is a collection of data elements which are stored in such a way that one element points to the next element which is present in the list. So this pointing what we have, that is one element pointing to the other element, what we have, it forms a linking between each of the elements. It forms the linking between each of the elements. So therefore, and it is the list what we are talking of. So this is what linked list is formed of. So you have a list which will be linked with the elements which are present in the list. So let us move further and see what are the other aspects. Now we have two things. What are the data elements which are present in the linked list called as? They are called as the nodes. So each data element along with some logical connection which is present in that, it is termed as a node. So in the data element, you can just check out what all parameters will be there. So we'll just observe in the coming forth discussion. So we have data elements that are logically connected to each other. So these data elements which are logically connected to each other form the node. And this linked list is the collection of these kind of nodes. So these it is a collection of data elements which are logically connected with each other. So this is the different way of defining what is a linked list. So now in this, we specified the node. So nodes are nothing but the elements which are present in the linked list. Now, basically, when we are talking that the data elements are connected, so indirectly nodes, if I specify that there are two, three nodes, how they are interconnected. So if I talk of that, we have to have two parts in the nodes. So that is the data element along with some other parameter. So two data elements to be interconnected to each other, that is logically connected to each other. That is when we consider the entire node, it should have two parts. One part is called the info part, which contains the actual data element, And there is another part, sometimes instead of part, we call it as field. So there is another part or field which is called next. So what does this hold is, it contains the address of the next node. So when I'm talking of node, what we have? We have data element and we have a pointer. So this entire thing is a node. So and these data elements has to be interconnected. So that is indirectly the nodes have to be interconnected. So now in order to perform that, what happens is node will contain the data element which holds the actual value. This is the info field. It is the info field, and we have another field which is named as next. So this basically contains a pointer. So what is this pointer pointing to? It is pointing to the next node I can specify. It is pointing to the next node, which will contain its own data element and another pointer. So this is your info field. This is your next field. So this is what a node consists of. It consists of two parts. One is the info, which is the actual data element, and one is the next field, which contains the address of the next node. So this is so each node will be consisting of these two aspects. Now basically what is present in the next node of the next part of the last node. So here this will be clear when we go ahead with the rest of the discussion. So I'll come back to this part once I discuss this aspect. So here we can see that this is one node, this is another node, so on. You can have n number of nodes in the linked list, and each node, if you just observe, it is containing two fields or the two parts. One is the info part and the next part. So again, you can observe one is the info part and the next part. So all the n nodes will be containing these two parts. So if you just observe, this is the data element, and the next part will be containing the pointer, which will be pointing to the next node. So in order to specify this thing, if you just observe, so this is the first element or the first node. Say if I just specify it as N1. So it is the first node of the linked list. So its info is the data element which is specified over here. That is info one, and next one is actually pointing. That is, this field is pointing to the next node. So if I specify that, this is N2. So this one will be containing address of this N2. So address of N2 is basically identified with what? Address of this data element. So address of node 2 can be obtained by the address of this info 2. So what is done is, in order to logically link node 1 and node 2, you have to access the address of the next node. And store that address information along with this parameter, that is in the node 1. So here what is happening, next one, which is part of the node 1, will contain the address of node 2. So similarly, if I have to logically connect to the node 3 value, I should know what is the address of node 3, which is accessed by the data element of the node 2. So this is the data element. Info 2 will be containing the data element. So if you access the address of that and you give that information in, if you store that information in this field, I'll get a linkage, logical linkage between node 2 and node 3. So this can continue till say n number of nodes are present. So now here one thing to identify, how do I identify that this is the first element of the list? So this is the entire linked list. How do I identify that this N1 is the first node? So for that purpose, what I do is I use a special pointer which is termed as first in this case. So that is a first is a special pointer which helps us to identify the beginning of the list. So it helps us to identify the beginning of the list. So basically it contains what? It contains the address of this node one. It contains the address of the node one, and this address of node one is stored in a parameter which is named as first. So now apart from that, how do I identify that this is the last element in the linked list? So in order to do that, again, we make use of a special pointer, which is termed as last. So this is a special pointer which helps us to identify the end of the list. So if I use this, say pointer named as last, I get to know what is the address of the last node. What is the address of the last node? So this parameter holds the, it is a special pointer which holds the address of the first node, and this parameter which is termed as last holds the address of the last node. So that is in this entire linked list. Now here if I just observe what is happening is, so here I have node 1 which is connected to node 2. So similarly node 2 to node 3. So similarly node n minus 1 to node n. So this is your node n. Now after this there is no node because this is say the last node which is present. Now how do I so in this case what will be the value which will be stored over here? Because as per definition what it specifies, a node is having two parts. One is the info and one is the next. So info contains the data element, next contains the address of the next node. But in this case there is no next node. There is no next node. So what is done is, if the element is the last element, that is in this case node n, this is the last node in this entire linked list. So what is done is, in this case, this field, that is the next field, is stored with the null value. It is stored with the null value. So in the next part of the last node, that is this is the last node, and in this part, and in this part, we store a null, which basically helps us to indicate that it is the end of the list. So here we have two ways of going ahead. So this is holding the address of this data element. So using this, I can identify that, okay, this is the last element. And if I just cross verify with this one, so it should be containing a null value, indicating that this is the last node. This is the last node. Since the node should contain the two fields, info and the next field. So in this case, what should be the next field? It should be stored with the null value. It should be stored with the null value. If you don't store, if there is some garbage value, then what will happen is it might point to some other aspect. Some of the operations which are performing on the linked list might fail. So because you will be using all these aspects, say the info field, the next field, the null pointer, the first special pointer, last special pointer, all these parameters you will be utilizing for one or the other operations. So next, when we have a linked list, so how do we start off with the linked list? Suppose say I am having a node one. Suppose say I am having node one. So this is not present. I want to add new node to this. So if this is the only node, that is only node one is present in the list. Say this is not there. So this is not there. So if that is the case, so what happens is, first and last will be storing the same address. First and last will be storing the same address, and here it will be a null value. Say if only one element is present. So now if I want to add a new parameter to this, that is new node to this, then what I have to do? First, I should get access to the data, then create a space for that data in the memory, and then logically connect this node and the next node what you are generating. So in this case, what happens is, So I'll just write this one as the last value, and this one previously was containing, say, the null value. Say only one element is present. So I am adding node 2. So what I have to do is, how do I add the element to the list? First, I create a node. So how do I create a node? I access the address of the memory location. First, I block the address of the memory location. I access this. So once I access this, in this address, I'll store the info 2 value. At this address, I'll store the info 2 value. And the address of info 2 is stored in the next field of node 1. It is stored in the next field of the node 1. So by this, what happens? There is a logical connection between node 1 and node 2. So once this is done, you get to know that this is not the last element. So now in this case, this becomes the last element. So this is removed, and what is done? The last address is updated over here, and in this case, null will be updated. So this process will continue as long as how many nodes you want to add. So whenever you want to add a new element to the list, first you create a node and then append the new node at the end of the list. So you are appending it always at the end of the list. If you want to say insert somewhere in between, then you have to look into the logical parameter. That is, you have to link the address. Suppose in between, if you want to add some node over here, so you should store next to a field with the address of this node, and address of this parameter should be stored in the next field of this one. So in this way, in between also you can insert, but the general concept what they look forward is you try to append the new node at the end of the list. So this is how you go ahead, and these are the concepts pertaining to linked list. So let us look at a few of the specifications pertaining to the linked list. So the first question which we have is, do the linked list occupy contiguous memory locations? So previously we saw in arrays, we discussed that whenever we declare an array, it consumes fixed amount of memory location. And apart from this, another aspect is it uses contiguous memory location. It uses contiguous memory locations. That is, if say I am storing integer, if the first data is stored in 6000 and if integer consumes 2 bytes, the next element in the array will be having address of 6000 plus 2, which is 6002. So on, it will be stored. So what happens is, in array, the data elements are stored in a contiguous memory locations. So the first question with the linked list would be, does linked list occupy contiguous memory locations? So I cannot necessarily tell that it can or cannot, because it is not necessarily that it will occupy the memory locations. So why we specify it in this form is, we make use of dynamic memory allocation. So which is basically done with the help of instructions such as calloc and malloc, if you remember those. So you have a function which is called as malloc, which is memory allocation. So that is used when you want to allocate a memory to a parameter during the runtime. So in that case, what happens is, suppose you have a very big memory. So, and these are some of the memory locations. So when I run malloc, what happens is it gets access to a memory location, and it sees where the free memory location is there, and it fetches that information and gives the address of that location. So suppose in that case, what happens is I cannot tell that, say, first node when I'm storing. So first node when I'm storing, I made use of memory allocation. Say address of 6000 was accessed. So in this case, I'll be having address of 6000 for node 1. So when I run the program next time, what happens is this memory location might be say 6004 or 2 something. Say if it is 6002, if that is free, say it might allocate this to new node. But if there is say a next node, what happens is it might not be 6002, it might be something as 9000. It might be 9000. So next address might be somewhere 4000. So it might go in this form. But in some cases, what happens is it might go in continuous form, because if those locations are free, it might access those dynamically and fetch it. So therefore, what happens is we cannot directly specify that it occupies consecutive memory locations. It is not necessary in that way. So whichever memory location is free, it is accessed and given to the node. So you might get consecutive memory locations in some cases, but in some cases you might get a non-consecutive memory locations. So majority of the time it will be not consecutive or the contiguous memory locations. What we have specified over here, that is, does they occupy contiguous memory locations? Not necessarily under this. So that what happens is the data elements can be stored in discrete memory locations. Discrete memory locations in the sense, so if this is 6000, it is not necessarily that this has to be 6002 if it is say using integers. So it can be something else. So it can be say around 9001. This can be around 4020. So something in this form. So these are the discrete memory locations. But what is the important thing? They have to be logically connected. How they are connected? They are connected with the help of the next field. Each element are connected with the help of the next field. So this is the aspect of memory allocation pertaining to the linked list. Now, what are the advantages of having this linked list? So we can see that we are making use of the dynamic memory allocation. So this is that when we allocate memory, say to say a parameter or a variable during the runtime. So if you're doing it, say at the compile time, what happens is that is at not the runtime, it is called a static memory allocation. It is called a static memory allocation. But during the runtime, you are trying to decide where you are storing the data. So that will form the dynamic memory allocation. So if you're doing this, what is happening is, so if you just compare, so this with the array. So in array, what is happening? So whether it is one element, two element, 10 element. So if you're declaring the array, so if you're declaring array of 100 elements, so 100 consecutive memory locations are being allocated to the array, which is named as A. So this is static memory allocation, which is being done. I cannot change it during the runtime. So what is happening is if you're just storing one or two elements and remaining memory locations are not utilized. So what is happening? These 98 memory locations are not being utilized in an efficient way. They are kept aside for this array element. So, but in this case, what happens if you have just one element, you create the node, that is you create a new node and you make a logical connection between the nodes. So here what happens if only one element is there, the last field will be containing over this part and there will be a null over here. So suppose in future I have to store few more, say I have to store another 99. So what we do is we use dynamic memory allocation and we create say memory for the next node, memory for the next node. So as and when it is required, right? We create those memory locations, that is we get access to the memory locations at the runtime and allocate it to the nodes. So in this way, what is happening is the problem what we observe in the arrays is overcome. So in 98 memory locations which are there, so in a previous case, in this case, what happened? If these two elements are there, you just allocated the memory which is required for this part. So remaining 98, you can utilize it in an efficient way. You're not wasting that memory. So that is what you are looking forward. So here what happens is you are using the memory in an efficient way or utilizing the memory in an efficient way. So what why is this required? It is required in the process of addition or deletion of the elements in the linked list during the runtime. So that is what we can observe in the linked list. Now, what about adding the elements or deleting the elements in the linked list as compared to the arrays? So in previous discussion, we had seen that suppose if I want to add or delete an element in an array. So if you remember, suppose I have some numbers stored here. Suppose I have some numbers stored over here. Now I want to insert element somewhere here. That is, if these are the indexes, so I want to insert an element at index 2. So what I should do, I should move this element over here and this element over here. So I should perform this operation and then insert the element. And if I want to delete this element, I have to move the previous elements towards the new location. So here, what you're doing, you are shuffling the elements. In array, what you're doing, you are shuffling the elements. So in array, basically shuffling of the elements is being carried out for insertion and deletion operation. But what about the insertion and deletion in the linked list? What we do is, if we want to insert a new node in this one, we create a node and create a logical connection between the previous node and the present node. Suppose in between, I want to add over here. So what we do is, first we create a memory location and then we link this address of the node over here, and address of this one is updated in the next field of this parameter. So this is the simple operation what we can observe over here. Whereas in the previous case, what was happening? You are shuffling. So in that shuffling, indirectly, what you are doing, you are changing the address parameter. So if this element had to be deleted, so the address of 21 has to be changed. So here, if it is in index 3, its index has to be changed to 2. So it is because array holds the array elements are consecutive, are stored in consecutive memory locations. So in order to hold that, we have to perform this operation. So whereas in this case, that is not the problem. So therefore, it is easy to insert or delete an element. Now, what about deletion? So in deletion, if I want to delete this element, so what I do is I get the address of the next node. So this is still there. So address of this element. So this is holding the address of the next node, which is logically connected to the previous node. So I get this address. I store that address over here. So in this way, what is happening? Link between these two nodes is created and indirectly this element is deleted. So this is the logical aspect of inserting and deleting an element in a linked list. So it is easier as compared to the arrays. Whereas in arrays, what we are doing, we have to shuffle the entire thing if you are inserting or deleting. Now, what are the disadvantages pertaining to this? So if we just observe other parameters, how much memory will be consumed? So if we come to this part, right? Suppose the array has two elements. So it is having 1 and 3. So these are the two elements which are present in the memory location. So if I check what is the size of this array. So if I assume that 2 bytes and 2 bytes are consumed for the integer. So the size of this array is how much? It is 4 bytes. Size of this one is 4 bytes. Now suppose if the same thing, if I want to store it using linked list. So in this case, I had 2 bytes. So 1 and 3. So here it consumed around 4 bytes. Now, if I do the same thing with linked list, then what happens is you have data element 1. Then you have address over here, which is the next field. And next you have 3 over here and you have the address parameter. So here, if I just consider only this part, so this is consuming 2 bytes, this is consuming 2 bytes, but this is the address parameter. Suppose if the address is 16 bit, just for example, I'm just taking. So if it is 16 bit, So you have, you will be consuming another 2 bytes. So because 8 bits is 1 byte, so this address space will be consuming another 2 extra bytes. So this also will be consuming another 2 extra bytes. So if I just observe, I'm just considering this part. So if I just observe how much this thing we have 8 bits, 8 bytes. So this is consuming 4 bytes. This is consuming around 8 bytes. So apart from that, if I just consider the next, the first field value, then the last field value and the null parameter. So if these again consume two bytes, so it will be around plus 6 bytes additional. So it will be around total 14 bytes. So what is happening? For storing same amount of data, what is happening is linked list will consume more amount of memory. It will consume more amount of memory. So that is more memory space is required as compared to the array. It is because of the additional field what we have. This field which is present, right? Because of this, the memory requirement increases. So if it is an integer, this is consuming 2 bytes, and say if 16 bits of address is there, 16 bits of allocation will be there, which is actually around again 2 bytes. So 2 bytes. So it will be total 4 bytes. If I consider these also bytes, because it is again address itself. So if there is a last field over here, then this is around 2 bytes. There will be a null which will be stored. So it might go, if it's a character what we consider, it will actually consume 1 byte. So we'll not confuse that. We'll just consider, because since it is the parameter over here, it will be 2 bytes. So it will be additional around again 6 bytes extra. So it is because of the next field what we have in the linked list. Because of that, it consumes more amount of memory. Now, what about accessing an element in the linked list? So in array, if we just observe, it is pretty much easy to access the element, because in order to access the element in the array, what we have to do? If I have to access an element in the array, so I have an array which is named as A, and I have some data which is stored over here. Then I have the index associated with this. So if I have to access the third element, so I should know what is the index of this and what is the name of the array. So if I just write A of 2, I'll get the access to the data element 4, which is present in the array. But in this case, if I want to know what is the data element which is present in the last node, I cannot directly go and access this part. So I have to traverse from the first node and then move ahead with the interconnection and see what is the last node. I have to see what is the last node. So this is, suppose in between I have some other element. I want to know what is the second data which is present. So in last I can directly utilize this also, that is also fine. But if I want to access data in between, say I want to access which is the second element. So I have to start with the first element and then see over what is the next element. So if I have to access what is the n minus 1th element, so again traverse from the first element, move towards this and see what is the aspect over there. So this is how you traverse in the or access the elements in the linked list. So it is because there is no index which is associated with the elements which are present in the linked list, and therefore we need to traverse by looking at the predecessor. That is, if you just look out here, n1 is predecessor and n2 is the successor of this node. So that is preceding element. N2's preceding element is n1. So if I have to get access to n2, right, pass from n1 and then go to n2. Directly I cannot get access to n2. So this is the disadvantages what we observe in the linked list. So in next session, we'll look at the implementation of the linked list. Okay. So in which we'll look forward for a few of the operations which are performed on the linked list. And then we'll look at few of the programs which are pertaining to linked list. So this is all for today's session. Let us meet in the next session. Thank you.